Hey, Ruth, welcome. I think it's the first time I've seen you stop by live stream. Happy to have you. Ruth says, someone shared a, quote, futuristic AI landscape with me a while back. It was a filtered picture of the bean, a piece of public art in Chicago. I recognized it instantly. Yeah, and some of them it is thinly veiled. It is. It's very thinly veiled when they say, oh, allegedly, it's creating new works. It's thinly veiled. It's got what I was saying is it's a machine. It's got to process material that already exists. And then it takes that material. And the argument is that it's not stealing as much as the AI generator is learning. It's getting inspired, almost as if they're trying to argue that the artificial intelligence has an imagination of its own, which is bullshit, by the way, because if you understand anything, the most rudimentary aspects of computer code, you would know that that's bullshit. A computer does not have an imagination. It is a machine. It has lines of code. It has an operating system. It runs through a checklist of functions that it has to go through. I've said it's not the same thing as a human being looking up images on Google and then trying to use those images as inspiration and then use their own human mind imagination, which is something that is however you want to describe it. I told you, I'm going to touch upon the metaphysics a little bit, whether you want to call it the divine spark, mankind's divine spark, the human imagination, you know, almost like mankind's connection to the big man upstairs, the powers that be, something otherworldly, you know, that is how you explain the human imagination, you know, our third eye, whatever you want to call it. The computer does not have that. So it's not the same as saying a human being looking at a picture and then trying to use their own motor functions and imagination to kind of recreate that image on their own. Now, I said, if you're going to argue that way, the closest thing you could do is say, all right, it's like printing out an image, putting a piece of tracing paper over it, and then training your muscle memory that way and saying, oh, okay, I want to draw something like a tiger or something like that. And then I train my muscle memory. And then over time, I can kind of do it without using the image, and then I can just draw it just from muscle memory alone, and then I can start tweaking it and moving it around and kind of try to have it in different stances and whatnot, you know. And that's, and then even then you could argue, is that art, you know, or is it really just someone who is learning theory, who is learning craft, you know what I mean? Because I also argue that theory and craft in it and of itself is not art. But that's a debate for another time. What I'm saying is any Tom, Dick, or Harry can go to art school and learn theory, okay? You learn theory. And that's going to make it so you know the tips and the tricks to drawing this or that, and technique, understanding technique. But is that art, though? Art. So just what I want to tap into here, art of something else is something that is more metaphysical. It's more philosophical. And up until this point in history, it has always been something that was distinctly human. Up until this point in history, it has always been recognized as something that is distinct to human beings, to mankind, separating us from the animal kingdom. You know? And it's our way, you know, art, for me, my understanding of art, which is not extensive, you know, I don't have a liberal arts degree, don't plan on ever having a liberal arts degree, but that's neither here nor there. Art to me is something that has always been known as distinctly human, and subsequently I recognize it as what makes it distinctly human is it's always been all throughout history. It's always been our means of exploring the question, what does it mean to be? So what does it mean to be alive? What does it mean to be a lover? What does it mean to be in love? What does it mean to be a villain? What does it mean to be this? What does it mean to be that? What does it mean to be human? Because that's not a question that science can answer. It's a very philosophical, metaphysical type of question. You know, it's a loaded question as well. And it's a question that mankind has always pondered, you know, all throughout history. And it's something that I feel like it's a way of like relating to each other as well in that way. You know, it's mankind's way of, you know, like when something is a work of art, like it's almost like it's an unspoken thing. It's like you just know when something, like you feel it, you know, it's like a feeling, you know, maybe not necessarily just based on emotions, but it's just like something about it, a je ne sais quoi, if you will. You know, I might sound a little bit pretentious there, but you know, that's the angle I'm trying to put out there, because people just keep talking about this AI stuff and they're looking at it from a very pragmatic lens. They're thinking, oh, I'm just going to make money, just make money, churn out, you know? Oh, I'm going to learn how to, you know, write the prompts and I'm going to be able to have Shakespeare on a snap of my fingers. I'm going to have Shakespeare. But you don't, I feel like you're not addressing the elephant in the room, that's not art. You have a product. Yes. You have a product that you of your own free will, you're using this AI stuff. You're using it. And I understand there are people that are going to want to take advantage of it. I get that. And I understand it from that pragmatic sense that the AI is going to become more intelligent and it's going to eventually pass the Turing test, okay? Which is why I've also brought up that there has to be accreditation. We have to become perhaps a little bit more diligent in terms of understanding where our products come from. I know that could be a big ask for some people because, you know, that's where I say accreditation. Because for me, if I look at a piece of work and I'll be honest with you, I'm not typically looking at the copyright page. Like when I'm reading literature and stuff like that, I don't always know like who the publisher was, you know, I mean, know who the author is. You know, but I'm not doing research. I'm not always doing research on an author like, oh, I want to know their personal life. That's what I mean. Like, I'm able to separate the art from the artist in that aspect. I just want to read a good story, right? So I don't really care so much about the author's personal life. I don't care if they're problematic, you know, or anything like that. A book is a book is a book. If you want, you read whatever you want to read. There shouldn't be banned books as far as that goes. Definitely a strong proponent of free speech. But in terms of this accreditation stuff, I think that as this AI thing, since it's so new and fresh, it's like, I think that it really should be, I don't want more regulation too. It's a conundrum. That's the word. It's a conundrum because I don't want more regulation. That's the last thing that we want too. Because I almost feel like this AI thing, another kind of angle that you come at this AI thing almost being used as a red herring to kind of slip in more free speech regulation through the back door. You know, that could be another angle you're looking at it as. And I don't want more regulation. However, I would like to know if what I'm reading or what I'm looking at was derived by an artificial intelligence generator. Because for me, because people may say, well, what's the point? I mean, what's the difference? If you can't tell if it was made by a human being or AI generator, well, what's the difference? Well, the difference being, well, for one, it takes away from the artistic merit. For me, that's a personal value judgment, okay? That may not be true for everybody. Doesn't necessarily take away from the artistic value, like, and in the market value, but it would certainly take away from artistic merit in my eyes. And the reason for that is because at that point, it's not distinctly human. I say before, it's a metaphysical thing. So now it has you questioning the meaning. Everything that was in that work, it has you questioning what the hell all that shit was all about. At least for me. And for me, that's what I mean by art. Because say you watch a movie and it's really moving to you, or you read a book and it really makes you think. It changes your whole outlook on life. That's art. But at the same time, I think what makes it art is knowing the fact that that came from a human being. And that was how a human being thought. And you're like, holy shit. Like, I wonder if that person was all alone in that way of thinking, you know? And that may persuade you, that may inspire you to look into that individual's life, maybe learn a little bit about the author and see, and that may, you know, that goes into the whole process of like understanding a work of art, like what goes into the work, where were they coming from? What was their history like? So it does make you like look into it and you want to know those things. So, you know, I just wanted to kind of bring that angle up and bring up that subject because I don't feel like there's a lot of people looking at it like that. And I feel like it's kind of an explanation as to why the AI and artificial intelligence the artificial intelligence and art conversation is so emotionally charged.